So, we shall start with this formal treatment, and this formal treatment is represented by a very important rule or principle called Boltzmann superposition principle. Now, obviously, the Boltzmann superposition principle is not confined to rheology. Boltzmann superposition principle, Boltzmann was not a rheologist. It is a very common principle applicable in many fields of science and engineering. What does this principle say? This principle says that whenever initiating signal is applied independently, response gets added linearly. Alright. So, independent signal as far as rheology is concerned could be application of stress or strain. If application of stress is initiating signal, then response is the other one. So, if you apply stress, response is strain. If you apply strain, response is stress. Alright. So, what it simply says is that if stress acts on material independently, strain adds linearly, or if strain acts independently, stress adds linearly. Alright. So, what we will now do is that we will consider a very generalization of this particular statement. Alright. So, what we shall do is that we shall simultaneously consider a situation where there is application of stress and there is application of strain. All right, we will consider these two cases simultaneously. So, what we will say is that application input is, let us say, first stress, and at time t equal to t 0, a certain constant stress has been applied to a material. Similarly, at time t 0, a constant, let us say, step strain is applied to a material. This is an independent application, this is strain. And what is going to be the corresponding response as far as strain in this case is concerned? We know that when there is an application of step stress, at identical time, what you will find is that strain will start increasing something like this. Alright. On the other hand, if we maintain strain like this on material, and this is stress as a function of time, what happens? You may get a stress relaxation that looks something like this. All right, we can represent this response gamma as gamma is equal to, we know that strain is equal to compliance into stress, but we will write down here as j minus j of t minus t 0. This is how we will, and this is sigma 0, because at time t equal to 0, the stress that we applied is sigma 0. Fair enough. On the other hand, we can represent stress induced in material similarly as g of t minus t 0 into gamma 0, where this step strain magnitude at time t equal to 0, let us say gamma 0. Fair enough. And this is going to be its response. Okay. So, this is impetus multiplied by response function is equal to response. Impetus multiplied by response function is equal to response. All right, it is as simple as that. All right, the meaning of this particular t minus t 0 is that for times t less than t 0, obviously nothing is acting. So, response function is equal to 0. It is like a unit step function, but this is not a unit step function. It has that flavor of unit step function where below t equal to t 0, this has value of 0. Same is the case with this. All right. So, this is for the first step. Then what we will do is that will consider another independent application of stress at time t equal to t 1, and the independent application of stress that we will do will be, let us say, sigma 1. All right. Now, sigma 1 is an independent application, which means that it will be on top of this. Okay. So, let us say this is t 1 and this applied is sigma 1. All right. Same thing we can do over here also. We will say that we apply gamma 1 at certain time t 1. Is that all right? What does Boltzmann superposition principle say? That when stress acts independently, strain adds linearly. So, response of this, let us say, is going to be again that looks something like this. But what is going to happen now? That stress is acting independently. So, this response and this response will now get added independently, and the overall response, this response otherwise would have looked something like this, but now this response will look something like this. All right. Similarly, over here, because of this additional application of strain, what has happened is that you essentially have a sudden increase in strain, and independent, by independent application, let us say it would have become something like this, but now it will get added. So, whatever is there over here will also get added to this. So, what we shall essentially get is something like this, which will be addition of both. Are you getting this? So, response after t equal to t 1 can be then represented as this equal to j of t minus t 0 sigma 0 plus j of t minus t 1 sigma 1. Here we can write down sigma equal to g of t minus t 0 into gamma 0 plus g of t minus t 1 into gamma 1. All right. This is kind of a Boltzmann superposition principle when application of impetus is at times which are well separated. Is that all right? Now, what we are essentially saying is that if at various times different independent applications of stress or strain occur, then we can simply represent this particular expression as gamma is equal to summation over n j of t minus t sub n sigma n, and here we can then represent this as summation n g of t minus t n gamma of n. Is this fine? Now, we shall say that the subsequent application of stress, the time duration between subsequent application of stress, it is so tiny, which means it is infinitesimal. So, that this summation can now be converted into an integral. All right. If the time duration between two subsequent application, independent applications of stress, if this time tends to 0, it becomes infinitesimal, then this summation can be converted into integral, which essentially looks like gamma is equal to j of t minus t prime. At various t primes, you are applying stress field or strain field, in this case stress field, d sigma by dt prime, and we saw in, of course, this has to be t, this is minus infinity. This information we are simply borrowing from last class, where I explained, we discussed that why this should be minus infinity. All right. Similarly, we can write down over here that sigma of t is equal to minus infinity to t
g of t minus t prime d gamma by dt prime.
Fair enough? So, what we have essentially obtained is a generalized expression of Boltzmann superposition principle. This is in here independent variable is stress, here independent variable is strain, here dependent variable is strain, here dependent variable is stress. All right, in both forms we have obtained this particular expression of Boltzmann superposition principle. All right, keep in mind that neither this information is independent of this information, which means that both equations convey identical information. Only thing is that because this material is identical, if the material is identical, then this j of that material and g of that material are not independent of each other. All right, it is the same material. If you apply stress, strain will be the response. If you apply strain, stress will be the response, which means that all the information that is contained in this equation is also present in this equation. All right, and you can see that various variables are also similar. Here is gamma, here is sigma, sigma, gamma, here is g, which simply means that let us say if you have two linear equations and let us say there is x and y here and some let us say constant over here, x and y here, again some constant over here, then we can always kind of work both these equations out and we can in principle obtain a relationship between this and this, right. But this equation is not in linear form, this is of course an integral equation. It is not that work to obtain relationship between j and g the way one can do it with simple equations, all right. But it is certainly not impossible, all right. So, what we shall do is that we shall now discuss how to use these equations and then what more interesting aspects we can get out from this particular equation, all right. Yesterday somebody was asking me that why to work with integral equations, okay, differential equations are sufficient enough. You will realize that if we take Laplace transform of this equation, these equations become extremely simple, okay. These equations then actually become something like y equal to mx type of equation. Those equations become so simple in Laplace domain, so it is beneficial to carry out analysis of linear viscoelasticity in frequency domain, that is in Laplace domain, that in rather than working in the real time domain, all right. So, I will give you a flavor of doing that. What we shall do is that before carrying out Laplace transform of these equations, what we shall do is first we shall integrate this equation by parts, all right. We have one component, one entity in this particular one variable, this second variable we will perform integration by parts over here, then we will do same thing over there, and then what we obtain after integration by parts, we will carry out Laplace transform of that, all right. So, let us do that. So, gamma of t is equal to, keep in mind that as far as both these equations are concerned, the definition of sigma here is sigma of t is equal to minus infinity to t d sigma by dt prime, okay. So, this is definition of sigma, and similarly definition of gamma of t prime is equal to minus infinity to t, just for simplicity, of course this also does not make any difference, but those who find this to be more convenient to understand, we can do that, d gamma by dt double prime. Is that all right? So, this is definition of stress and this is identical definition of strain. If you see rheology literature, then there are various ways to define strains, okay, but this is I would say a conventional way of defining strain, all right. It essentially suggests that how much material has been strained since you started applying deformation to the material, this is strain, and how much stress has now been accumulated in the material since you started applying stress, that is the first definition. Is that all right? So, let us now integrate this by parts, and what we essentially get is that, let us do that business for this one. What we get is J of, what we have is T minus T prime integral d sigma by d t prime, I should say d t double prime minus infinity to t prime, where the t prime goes from minus infinity to t minus infinity to t d j t minus t prime d t prime. What you essentially then have again is sigma of t prime dt prime. Okay, so this tends to be the integration by parts. If you have any query, please ask me right away.
So don't the equation sigma equal to g of t minus t naught, that is the this graph's equation, right? Sigma.
That is this graph. Yeah, absolutely right.
T equal to t naught, we will get sigma as 0, but here we have positive value.
At t equal to t naught, what we will get? We will get 0, but what that 0 would be? That simply means t is equal to t 0, that is sigma of t 0. Sigma of t 0 does not, g of t 0 does not mean g has to be 0, right? All right. You will, you did not attend last class, right? So, we derived expression for g. If you have that expression for g, then you will realize that g of 0 tends out to be equal to g 0, which is a constant, which essentially is the permanent deformation that occurs in a spring. All right? No. I am so sorry. Here it should cannot. This is right actually. Whatever has been done is absolutely right. We are not changing the limits. This is perfect. Where have I changed the limits?
What's t dash?
T dash is a dummy variable. T dash is here, right? So I am saying that t dash goes from minus infinity to t. Okay. So here this has been carried out over t double dash, so that its upper limit is t dash, which goes from minus infinity to t. Are you getting it? Here t dash goes from minus infinity to t. Here this t dash goes from minus infinity to t. This is absolutely right. No problem with this expression. All right. So let's work this out. This then tends out to be, this becomes j of at minus infinity, at when t prime is minus infinity, what you essentially have is j of infinity, but this will also be infinity minus. So, this will be minus infinity to minus infinity. So, this is going to be the lower limit, but why am I taking the lower limit over here? First, we should be taking the upper limit. Upper limit is simply at t prime is j of 0, and this at this is simply sigma of t minus this. Minus, of course, I have this particular same expression minus infinity to t dt prime. All right, you can very clearly see that since this limit is from minus infinity to minus infinity, this term will be equal to 0. So, I can simply represent now this gamma of t as j of 0 sigma of t minus infinity to t dj t minus t prime by dt prime sigma of t prime dt prime. All right. So, this is now the expression, same expression as this expression, but we have simply integrated this expression by parts. We can similarly integrate this expression also by parts, which leads to
sigma of t is equal to g 0 gamma of t minus infinity to t d g t minus t prime by d t prime gamma of t prime d t prime. Is that all right?
So, both these expressions are identical as these two expressions just obtained after integration by parts. Fair enough? Now, what we shall do is we will take Laplace transform of both these equations, all right, and you will realize that taking Laplace transform of these equations significantly simplifies this equation. Okay. Laplace transform will give you these equations on platter, literally speaking, which you can very easily work with. Okay. You will appreciate what I am saying when you will carry out the Laplace transform of these equations. So, let us do that.
So, first let me just give you definition of Laplace transform. If f of t is function of t which has non-zero value for t greater than or equal to 0, then I can represent Laplace transform of f of t which I will represent now as f of s is equal to 0 to infinity e to the power minus st f of t dt.
All right. So, this is a definition of Laplace transform. All right. So, what I am going to do now is that I am going to take Laplace transform of one of the equations. Let us start with the first equation. Okay. So, when I take Laplace transform of the first equation, what I get is that before taking Laplace transform of that equation, I want to do one more thing over here. So, let us quickly do that. What I am going to do now is that I am going to change variables of these equations. See, here there is t minus t prime. So, we will change that variable from t minus t prime to a. So, what we shall do is that we will assume that t minus t prime is equal to a. That makes it t prime is equal to t minus a. All right. As t prime tends to minus infinity, you can see a tends to infinity. At t prime tends to t, a tends to 0. All right. And dt prime is equal to minus of dA. All right. With this change in variable, we will just kind of now incorporate that in over here. What we get is gamma of t is equal to j of 0 sigma of t minus, then what we have is this minus infinity becomes infinity, this becomes 0. What we get is that dja by minus of dA, because dt prime is nothing but minus dA. What we get here is sigma of t minus a, and what we again get is dA, but that minus minus becomes plus. All right. And I can make this minus also plus and change the direction of limits. All right. And I can say that now this is from 0 to infinity. All right. Let us do same thing for the next expression also.
So, we have sigma of t is equal to g of 0 gamma of t plus 0 to infinity d g of a by d a gamma of t minus a d a.
All right. And now, what we will do now is that we shall take Laplace transform of that equation. All right. So, Laplace transform of gamma of t becomes gamma of s is equal to, the first term does not change, we simply have j of 0 as it is. The next is sigma of t simply gets converted to sigma of s. It is Laplace transform of stress plus, Of course, now that is Laplace transform of an integral. Okay, there is no straightforward way of doing it. So, what we shall do is that we will write down first a t integral which is 0 to infinity. I will put t over here representing that this integral suggests it is a t integral e to the power minus st, and our function now is that which is 0 to infinity. Now, this is an a integral. So, I will put a over here and I will write down it is d j a by d a sigma of t minus a d a d t. Is this all right? So, this makes this as Laplace transform. All right. Now, what I shall do is that we will change this integral. So, we will make, we will push this integral inside and we will take this integral out, all right, which then becomes, you can simply write down over here, plus 0 to infinity. Now, we are talking about a integral. You can very clearly see that this integral is over t. The first term is independent of t. So, I can simply put that t term here, d j of a by d a integral. I will write here 0 to infinity. Now, this is my t integral, where first term is of course e to the power minus s t sigma of t minus a, first now d t, then d a. Is this fine? There is no problem with this. All right. Now, what I am going to do is that you can clearly see over here that there is t minus a over here. So, if we write down t minus a over here, we will have to simply multiply this by e to the power minus a s, because as far as this inside part is concerned, a is constant. I can manipulate a. All right. So, I have gotten this over here. Now, what I will do is that rather than saying d t, I will say d t minus a, because a is constant. All right. But then I will have to change this integral now from minus a to infinity. All right. But what we are saying that this stress is applied for time t greater than a, means the time beyond a. All right. And this particular term is valid only for times greater than 0 as defined over here. So, below from minus a to 0, this is equal to 0. So, we will still come back here to 0. Okay. From minus a to 0, since this will be equal to 0, we again come back to 0 and we can now write down this adds. You can very clearly see, what is this? Can anybody say? What is this? Say it. It is Laplace transform of sigma. There is nothing but just, it is a definition of Laplace transform. We can simply take that out. So, what we get is gamma of s is equal to j of 0 sigma of s plus sigma of s 0 to infinity e to the power minus a s d j a by d a into d a. All right. But what is this? This is nothing but Laplace transform of d j. Now, we will simply call it d j t by d t, which is nothing but equal to s into this is the what we have from our Laplace transform fundamentals. All right. Now, what we shall do is that we will incorporate this in here, which will give us
sigma of s is equal to j of s plus s
alright. What does this say? This first term and the second term goes, alright. And what we get is s see beauty of Laplace transform. By carrying out Laplace transform of that this particular expression, what you obtained is something like y is equal to m into x, all right. Now, what we have to do? We will now take Laplace transform of this equation also, but we do not have to now do it because we know how to do it, all right. We can now directly write down that Laplace transform, which looks now like I will write it over here sigma of s is equal to s g of s into gamma of s. Now, let us take a pause over here. Let us try to understand what we have obtained. All right. Keep in mind this j and g are the material functions, they are material properties. These stress strain or strain stress over here are either impetus or response, or either initiating signal or response, either it is a dependent variable or it is independent variable. When you work in this particular fashion for this equation, stress is definitely a independent variable, because then this expression becomes explicit in strain. If you have input of strain and if you have to output of stress, it is very cumbersome to kind of work with this equation, but not with this equation. It is only a Laplace transform of that equation. If there is input of strain, then you can move this whole thing over here and you can get output of stress, output as stress also. Same is the case with this also, all right. So, therefore, working in Laplace domain for linear viscoelasticity is far more easier than working in the real time domain, okay. So, therefore, when I take class, we actually kind of spend some time on doing Laplace transform and then we work only in Laplace domain, all right. Now, as I again told you that if you have y is equal to mx plus c, sorry, if you have y equal to mx, okay, and you have x equal to ky, then obviously there is a relationship between this m and this k, right. So, let us kind of now get rid of sigma as well as gamma from here. What essentially then we get is that if you incorporate this over here, then what you will simply get is 1 is equal to s square which means that knowledge of one response function leads to estimation of another response function, all right. Creep compliance which is j and relaxation modulus which is g are not independent of each other, is that all right? That is what essentially it suggests. Now, those who have little bit kind of further knowledge of Laplace transform will realize that this particular expression has a form of anybody? Yes, this expression has a form of somebody, some whatever somebody said was right. What is that? Cos? No, no, no. This form is known as, say it. This form is known as convolution, all right. And when you convert this back from Laplace domain to real time domain, what you essentially get is you have to take Laplace transform of this, Laplace inverse of this, what you get is 0 to t j of tau g of tau minus t tau. This equation is a very popular equation in rheology, it is known as convolution equation. This equation is known as convolution equation. Is that all right? Now, what I am going to show you is how this works from experimental point of view. So, what has been done is that we have taken PAM solution, PAM is polyacrylamide solution, and what we essentially do is that we apply step stress to it. We take sample, okay. We keep it in rheometer, wait for 2 minutes and apply step stress. What we get is creep compliance. We keep sample for 60 minutes, we keep sample for 105 minutes, and it is obvious that sample is at equilibrium. So, all the data you can see is absolutely on top of each other within experimental uncertainty, all right. Similarly, we apply step strain over here. You can see that this is decay in stress, this is decay in stress, this is decay in stress at different times. Again, this is equilibrium material, so there is no reason why it should have any TW dependence. So, when we subtract this, these times from this and plot it on the log scale, all the moduli also fall right on top of each other, same is the case over here also. But this is for the same material. What does that mean? This means that the information content in this is identical to information content in over here, which means that if I have this information, I should be able to obtain what happens in step strain experiment, all right. So, what we essentially now do is we, what I am saying is simply same thing over here, by equating Laplace transform we get this convolution equation. You can see this is that convolution equation over here, all right, and this convolution equation now tells you. So, what we have done is that we take this data, okay, and predict this line. This is not that straightforward integral to carry out actually numerically, but I had a student whose name is Manish Kaushal who did all these kinds of things. So, you can see that this is its prediction, and now you can take this data and you can predict creep compliance back, all right, which shows a very successful application of convolution relation for this viscoelastic material. Is that all right? Now, what we do next is something extremely important that forms something like a heart of rheology, all right. We studied primarily two flow fields, one is creep field, other one is stress relaxation field. So, if stress is significantly larger, then as a function of time, there could be a situation that system may go from linear regime to nonlinear regime. It means that if there is sufficiently large stress or strain acting on material, then one can essentially get into nonlinear regime. So, therefore, what is done is a sample is subjected to sinusoidal oscillations. Sample is subjected to sinusoidal oscillations such that this strain is well within the linear range of a material. This strain is well within the linear range of the material, all right. So, what is done is that sample is subjected to something called gamma equal to gamma 0 sin omega t, all right. If we take its derivative, then what we get is gamma 0 omega cos omega t. Now, in last class we studied that, and of course all of you know this also, that as far as Hookean material is concerned, Hookean elastic solid is concerned, the stress is directly proportional to strain. Stress is equal to Young modulus into strain, right. On the other hand, for Newtonian material, stress is directly proportional to rate of strain, where the proportionality constant is viscosity, all right, which means that if you are subjecting a material to a sinusoidal strain, then if material is perfectly solid, then the stress response has to be perfectly in phase with the strain applied. If maxima of stress and minima of stress, the period will always be the same, but maxima and minima, if they directly coincide with the maxima and minima of strain, which means that the stress output is in phase with strain input, and when it is in phase, you can very confidently say that it is a solid material, because stress is proportional to strain here. However, if material is liquid, then what will happen? The stress will become proportional to rate of strain, which means that the stress will now be in phase with gamma dot cycle. All right, the maxima of stress will now coincide with maxima of gamma dot and not maxima of strain. There will be a phase lag of pi by 2 between stress and strain, if material is perfectly liquid like. Fair enough? If material is perfectly if material is viscoelastic, which means it is not liquid like as well as it is not solid like, then the stress response will be intermediate to strain and strain rate. Fair enough? In that case, if applied stress, applied strain is like this, and if response is intermediate to sine and cos, they can, then we can resolve that particular stress response. We can write down that stress response is sine omega t plus delta. Delta will be equal to 0 for elastic material, delta will be equal to pi by 2 for viscous material, delta will be in between 0 and pi by 2 for viscoelastic material, and in that case we can simply resolve this into sum of in phase with strain and out of phase with strain. I am sorry, the here it should have been g prime, here it should have been g double prime. In phase is g prime, out of phase, there is a typo over here. All right. So, we can resolve it in phase and out of phase. All right. And from that, we can actually get this is g prime and g double prime for this particular experiment. All right. So, what we will do is that, since all of you are supposed to be good in mathematics, I am not going to kind of leave you guys over here. What we shall do is that we shall now derive expressions for g prime and g double prime from first principles. All right. For that, what we shall need is our original expression for Boltzmann superposition principle, which is given by. So, the expression for Boltzmann superposition principle is given by sigma is equal to minus infinity to t g of t minus t prime d gamma by dt prime dt prime. All right. And what did we say? We said that we are going to apply gamma is equal to gamma 0 sin omega t. Okay. You can say here, since this is dependent on t prime, you can make this t prime. Here. Fair enough, but we will now kind of work in the complex domain, because the integration and everything becomes much easier. So, we will write down this as real part of minus I gamma 0 e to the power I omega t prime. Fair enough? That makes gamma dot, which is nothing but d gamma by dt, as gamma 0 omega e to the power I omega t. Fair enough? So, what we should do is sigma is equal to minus infinity to t g of t minus t prime gamma 0 omega e to the power I omega t prime, let us put here t prime here dt prime. Is that all right? What we shall do now is we will kind of carry out the same treatment as we carried out over there, we will replace T minus T prime by A. All right. You can see over there all the limits and everything is mentioned over there. So, what we shall simply do is that we will use that limits and represent this equal to, we have gamma 0 omega over here, we will represent this as infinity to 0. This will simply become g of a, then we will have e to the power I omega t minus a, and this will be d a, but this will be minus of d a. So, this minus will essentially take care of this signs over here. So, we can simply write down this as 0 to infinity. Fair enough. Now, what we shall do is that we shall represent this stress to be equal to, now this is the most important step, we will represent this step stress. See, you can see over here that this is a complex number, all right. So, we shall now represent this stress as something called complex modulus into gamma, okay, where this complex modulus is defined as g prime plus I g double prime into gamma. Fair enough. So, what we will now do is that we will go here, we shall simply write down this as g star, and gamma is nothing but given by minus I gamma 0 e to the power I omega t prime, is not t prime, this is gamma of t now because we are outside, is equal to, and we have this expression over here which is gamma 0 omega 0 to infinity g of a into e to the power I omega t e to the power minus I omega a dA. Fair enough. This very clearly suggests that, see, this integral is over a, here t is merely a constant, all right. You can remove this, you can remove this, you can remove gamma 0, you can remove gamma 0, and what you essentially get then is g star is equal to I omega 0 to infinity g of a e to the power minus I omega a, which we can now, you can see that this is nothing but some kind of a Fourier transform type of relationship. The original Fourier transform goes from minus infinity to infinity, here it is only from 0 to infinity. We can now open this up to express g prime is equal to, so we know that I omega a is nothing but cos omega a minus I sin omega a dA. So, therefore, our g prime becomes omega integral sin omega a dA 0 to infinity, and g double prime becomes 0 to infinity g of a . So, one is cosine Fourier transform, other one is sine Fourier transform, all right, which very clearly tells you that the g prime and g double prime functions that we obtained, that are required, okay, can also directly be obtained from relaxation modulus, and there is a relationship between relaxation modulus and creep compliance. So, knowledge of one leads to knowledge of all others, all right. If this is sine Fourier transform and cosine Fourier transform, then you can invert these Fourier transforms to represent g prime and g double prime in terms of represent g of a in terms of g prime and g double prime, which is given by g g of a is equal to 2 by pi 0 to infinity g prime of omega divided by omega sin omega a d omega and g of a is equal to 2 by pi 0 to infinity g double prime of omega divided by omega cos omega a d a. Is that all right? So, knowledge of j will give you g from which you can obtain g prime and g double prime. Knowledge of g will give you j, you can get g prime, g double prime that also. Knowledge of g prime or g double prime will give you g from which you can get j also. What now only remains is that if you have g prime, then in order to get g double prime, you have to first obtain g and then use this to obtain g double prime. But again, we can use some mathematical tricks and from these two equations, we can get rid of this particular g a, or from these two equations, we can get rid of this g of a, and probably we can get direct relationship between g prime and g double prime. All right. So, let us do that exercise as well. So, what we have is now g prime of omega is equal to 0 to infinity, it is equal to of course, omega over here sin omega a, but g of a over here is nothing but this. So, we will simply put this over there, which is 2 by pi 0 to infinity g double prime of, will now make this omega look different than this omega because this is a different integral. Is that all right? Wherein this integral is of course, a integral and this integral is omega integral. Fair enough. Now, what we shall essentially do is that you can very clearly see that we can push this a integral inside, wherein only this part of this inside integral is function of a. All right. So, what we shall do is this equal to, we will have this omega over here, we will take this omega integral outside, we will say this is g double prime of omega divided by omega and we will take this integral outside, we will take this 2 by, so 2 omega by pi will come all the way out. And we will write down now here at 0 to infinity, this is now a integral, which is sin omega a cos omega bar a d a. Please check if I am not making any mistake. Fair enough. Now, you can very clearly see that this inside integral is a completely independent problem in itself. It has practically speaking nothing to do with, it does not depend on rheology per se, this is an independent problem. And for this problem, there is an independent solution available in the very common textbooks. You must keep in mind that sin omega a cos omega a is an odd function. All right. So, if you use properties of odd function, which allow inversion of this integral from minus infinity to 0, and then if you use the complex notation for to represent sine and cos, we can very easily obtain this particular integral. I am not doing that in interest of time, and the expression of that integral comes out to be. So, this comes out to be simply omega divided by omega square minus omega bar square. What we have is g double prime of this is a direct relationship between g prime and g double prime. This relationship in the literature is known as Cramer's Kronig relation. Again, like Boltzmann superposition principle, Cramer-Kronig relation is not only defined for rheology. Okay, it's present in many many fields of science and engineering. All right. Here, G prime, which represents the modulus associated with stress which is in phase of strain, is known as elastic modulus or storage modulus. On the other hand, g double prime, which represents that part of the resolved stress which is in phase of rate of strain, which represents liquid like behavior, is known as viscous modulus or loss modulus. Is that fine? So, this g prime means storage modulus, g double prime means loss modulus. Is that all right? So, with this, what shall we do is we have this particular expression for g star, all right, in terms of e to the power I omega a. What we will now do is that we will solve this for multimode Maxwell model. Okay. That will give us something very tangible in our hand. And then I will kind of talk some little bit more about applications of rheology. All right. So, as far as derivation is concerned, this is going to be the last derivation that we will be doing. So, what we will now do is that we will work with multimode Maxwell model. As mentioned in last class, multimode Maxwell model is nothing but the parallel arrangement of springs and dashpots, or I should say parallel arrangement of Maxwell models alright. And if this mode is 1, this mode is 2 and this mode let us say is n, then it is g of t minus t prime, or rather than writing t minus t prime, we will simply write down now g of a to be equal to summation over I. Let us not write down I, because we will be using I as square root of 1. So, we will say n is equal to, okay, say m is equal to 1 to n, and we will write down now this as g m e to the power minus t by tau n, tau m. You will realize that this was the same expression of relaxation modulus that we obtained in last class, all right, when we carried out the analysis for multimode Maxwell model, all right. So, what we will now simply do, I am sorry, this is a here, so there is to be a here. All right. So, we will now use this and incorporate this in this equation and solve this equation. All right. So, what we essentially have now is that g star of omega is equal to I omega 0 to infinity summation g m e to the power minus a by tau m e to the power minus I omega a d a. All right. So, this is the expression of, this is the expression that we need to solve. We can always take this summation out. So, what we get is g star of omega is equal to I omega, summation has been taken out, 0 to infinity g m is over m e to the power minus 1 over tau m plus I omega into a d a. Now, very clearly see that this g m also is a constant. So, we can write down this now as this is equal to I omega summation g m divided by 1 over tau m plus I omega 0 to infinity e to the power minus 1 over tau m plus I omega into a and d 1 over tau m plus I omega into a. All right. What we have simply done is that we have multiplied and divided by this 1 over tau m I omega. So, as to make this particular integral very straightforward, what we then get is g star of omega is simply I omega summation g m divided by 1 over tau m plus I omega into integral 0 to infinity e to the power minus x dx. Is that okay? So, this comes out to be directly from here. All right. And what is e to the power minus x dx? So, integral e to the power minus x dx from 0 to infinity is simply is equal to minus e to the power minus x from 0 to infinity, which is minus of, this is 0 minus 1 is equal to 1. Is that all right? Which means that we can simply get rid of this particular expression here, and this is what we get. Now, what we will do is that we will resolve this in real component and complex component, which actually then gives us what we have is g m I g m omega tau m divided by, we have multiplied and divided here by tau m, we get simply 1 plus I omega tau m. Now, again we will multiply and divide this by one minus I omega tau m and one minus I omega tau m. When we do that, what we essentially get is omega square tau m square I minus I square. So, this will be plus omega square tau m square g m divided by 1 plus omega square tau m square plus this into this, which is simply I into omega tau m g m divided by 1 plus omega square tau m square. But g star we have already mentioned is nothing but g prime plus I g double prime. Therefore, we can write down this as g prime is equal to, okay, I am sorry, here we in flow of doing things, I simply forgot to put summation everywhere. So, we have g prime is equal to summation g m omega square tau m square where 1 plus summation over m So, this becomes the expression for g prime and g double prime in terms of g m's and tau m's, which are nothing but various modes of Maxwell model. Is that right? Now, I will tell you how this can be used in our regular application. All these mathematics. Okay, so what you see over here is same as what is mentioned over here. All right, there is expression for g prime, and there is the other one is expression for g double prime. All right, now j is equal to 1 means no summation and only one term over here simply represents a single mode Maxwell model. How does single mode Maxwell model look like? Single mode Maxwell model essentially suggests that in a limit of very small frequency, g double prime, this is g double prime goes as omega to the power 1, while g prime goes as omega to the power 2. Okay. So, g prime, although it is smaller in amount, it increases very steeply and eventually crosses g double prime at some certain point. Beyond that, g prime becomes constant and g double prime again decreases with omega to the power minus 1 dependence. The point at which g prime and g double prime meet, you can see here, without this summation, if we equate g prime and g double prime without this summation, which means for a single mode, what we shall essentially get is omega square tau square is equal to omega tau. All right, everything else will simply go, which means that tau omega is equal to 1, which means that relaxation time of a material is simply the reciprocal of the frequency where g prime and g double prime meet. Okay. This is for a single mode Maxwell model. If you have, but the usually for some systems materials do behave as single mode Maxwell, but for usually the dependence of g prime and g double prime is far more complicated than single mode Maxwell. How to kind of deal with such situations? In order to deal with such situations, we use multiple modes. All right. So, you can see over here that a summation of 8 modes is shown over here, where these are different tau i's, and here it is mentioned eta i's, but eta I divided by tau I will give you g i's, which are mentioned over here. All right, it is mentioned in a different representation. So, tau i's divided, eta i's divided by tau i's will give you g i's, you have tau i's, and you can simply represent these 8 modes as single Maxwell units like this. So, you can see here that all these expressions over here are the single Maxwell parts of each of these modes. And if you add these up, what you get is this curve and this curve. Okay. When you have a real data, that real data looks something like this. Now, this is a real data. Okay. This data is a real data. What has been done is that by using these 3 modes, we essentially fit this particular data. And then what you essentially get from here is that by fitting this, what you get out of this is g i's and tau i's, where what you obtain is g of
t minus t prime is equal to summation I g I e to the power t minus t prime divided by tau I. This is what you get by fitting the data, and you can use this expression directly in your Boltzmann superposition principle, which essentially represents what you have is sigma of t is equal to integral minus infinity to t g of t minus t prime, which is nothing but this d gamma by dt prime.
So, what you do is that you first take a material, any material let us say has been given to you. Okay, let us say some person comes to you and shows you some kind of viscoelastic material, or for your research work you need to characterize that particular material. What you first do is that you take that material, put it in rheometer, assuming that that material is a thermodynamic equilibrium material, put that in rheometer, place the rheometer, both the kind of plates of rheometer on top of each other, and apply something called strain sweep under oscillatory mode. Okay. What you get is, if you apply strain sweep under oscillatory mode as a function of strain, so what you are essentially doing is that you are varying gamma 0 in that gamma 0 sin omega t for a given omega, omega constant, you obtain g prime and g double prime. And typically, if it is a viscoelastic material, then typically you work in the domain where omega is such that g prime is greater than g double prime, and what you get is that g double prime goes like this and starts decreasing, and g double prime does just something like this. Okay. So, this is g double prime and this is g prime. This limit below which g prime and g double prime are constant with respect to sigma 0, this limit is known as linear limit, and all the discussion that we have in the last two classes applies to this linear limit. Okay. You take certain gamma 0 in this limit now, which is a linear limit, and carry out something called frequency sweep on the material. So, in a frequency sweep, what you get is g prime g double prime in a linear limit. In a linear limit, if you change now, if you take any value of gamma 0, it is not going to affect your result. All right. What you get behavior is something like this. This is what will you get, okay, over a certain frequency domain. What you do is that take this experimental data and fit this to this data. What you will get out of it is g i's and tau i's, from which now you can represent relaxation modulus. Okay. Use that relaxation modulus in Boltzmann superposition principle, which means that by carrying out these two experiments, strain sweep and frequency sweep, now what you have in your hand is a constitutive equation for that viscoelastic material in its linear response regime. All right, which is a hugely beneficial when you have kind of you are dealing with a new material. You are developing a new material, and when you want to analyze that particular material. Yes, what is your question? Yes, there could be more than one intersection in g prime and g double prime curves. Absolutely applicable. I will actually kind of rather show you such kind of situation. I will have to, for polymeric materials, you can see here that how many intersections it is undergoing. This is g prime, but you can also should be able to appreciate that this is over 10 decades of time, 10 decades of frequency. It is very difficult to get it in a single measurement. For that, what you have to carry out something called time temperature superposition in order to get this. But that I am not going to cover in as far as this class is concerned, but you can see here that it undergoes different intersections. Interestingly, whenever G prime and G double prime cross each other, it represents some kind of relaxation, inverse of relaxation time associated there. All right. This is the lowest frequency for which G prime and G double prime overlap. So, this will be the most dominating relaxation time scale of the material. This will be the highest time scale of the material. All these time scales will be smaller than that, but whenever there is an intersection, you will find some time scale associated with the material. This is perfectly linear viscoelastic domain. Reptation time is related to entanglement. So, reptation time is roughly considered as inverse of frequency, where G prime and G double prime meet at the lowest frequency. All right, and then of course, there are other time scales over there. Is that all right? So, what we essentially have is that what you essentially get is that by carrying out this particular analysis, huge amount of information is now available with you. All right, once you have relaxation modulus, you also have creep compliance, you know how material will behave in creep. You also have obviously G prime and G double prime directly from here. All right. So, carrying out one strain sweep and one frequency sweep gives you kind of a good control over that particular material. Now, of course, we know that the response of viscoelastic response of a material is directly related to the molecular or microscopic nature of that particular material. So, now programs are available, now those programs are available even as open source codes also, that by simply obtaining this behavior, you can obtain the complete molecular weight distribution of that particular polymer. A huge information can be obtained from that. By carrying out this particular behavior, you will be able to say that whether a material is a gel like material, what kind of characteristic features that gel has, what kind of fractal dimension that gel has, all these informations you can obtain by simply carrying out these experiments. All right. So, with this now I conclude this kind of a introductory session on linear viscoelasticity. Of course, I will be very happy to take any questions, but the bottom line over here is that experimentally you obtain GIs and tau Is. With this you get something called relaxation modulus. Relaxation modulus is key to every other viscoelastic response function whose derivations we actually did in great details. Is that all right? And since we mentioned one important principle in last class, that behavior of any material can be represented by multimode Maxwell model. So, therefore, this particular exercise is applicable for any viscoelastic material that you come across. Only requirement is that that viscoelastic material should be an equilibrium material, it should not be a time dependent material. If it is an out of equilibrium material, then of course, this analysis becomes very, very complicated. All right. So, thank you, and I will be very happy to take any questions if there are. This way I conclude the two lecture series on introduction to viscoelasticity. Thank you.